Okay, we have a recognition. We want to start out with Dan.
Thank you, school board ladies and gentlemen, for allowing me the opportunity to recognize Hunter Crispin. Hunter works with me two periods out of the day, 6th and 7th, through the internship program that we have a combined working arrangement with Darren Parker from Tippecanoe Valley. And students have the opportunity to go out into the workforce and help companies. And Hunter chose to stay at the high school and help with the tech department. And as you know, we switched our operating platform from Windows to Macintosh, and he was very helpful with that. Taught me a whole bunch of things. But the one item that I want to really emphasize is we went through a project last summer of updating all of the infrastructure, connecting all the wireless access points and computers and whatnot back to our core switch. And we updated them from a 1 gig connection to a 10 gig connection. And we took a planned outage, and we ended up working until about 1:30 in the morning the next day. So Hunter, I was amazed and impressed. He was not only our gopher, he learned how to write code on these switches and build trunk ports and pools, and did amazing things, and really made some strong connections with our Cisco partner, and was very, very impressed by his willingness to learn and stay the whole night and help us out. In doing so, we didn't need another tech from Terre Haute to come up and help, so we were able to knock it out with one less man, not have to pay another person, so we saved most of the money there, and that money was then turned back into the project to just add some, not a lot, but a few loose edges that we feel made the system more reliable. So I wanted to just publicly recognize Hunter and all of his efforts. Hunter will be attending Trine next year and studying in cybersecurity. So I'm hoping to learn everything he learns. So, thanks, Hunter.
Thank you.
Hunter, Dan Funk has mentioned your name several times to me and what a wonderful job you do. And the entire time he's talking, Mr. Strasser is nodding his head yes. So thank you very much for your hard work and your help. And if you want to go, you can. You don't have to stay until 1:30 tonight for the board. Oh, neither is the board. They're saying it's not going until 1:30. But thank you.
Yes, thank you, Hunter. Appreciate it. Okay, we'll move on to consent items. We have the minutes of the March 16th regular meeting, minutes of the April 8th study session. Any additions or corrections? In the minutes?
I just have a couple of small things, Linda. On the minutes for the March 16th regular meeting, number 9, it must have just accidentally got in there from another meeting because it makes mention of Lisa, and poor Lisa was sick and wasn't here. And it's noted earlier that Lisa's not there. But at least on the copy that I received,
on number 9?
Number 9 on the minutes for the March 16th
right, okay.
meeting, it says that Lisa approved a motion. From her house, I guess.
From her house.
My very strong call.
I'll have to listen and see who did that, though.
But I wonder, we'll see, but the next one was that Don made a motion to approve the personnel recommendations.
Uh-huh.
So I wonder if maybe that was just an old one, because maternity leaves would have been personnel.
I'll look and see.
And then on number 14, this was just a typo, but it might come back if somebody was looking really closely later, like me, didn't have time or need to. When Jana was talking about working with Smith Sawyer and Smith, and it says here that they will advise there will be on additional charge.
No additional, yeah. Okay.
And then for the study session minutes, Sandy, you did a great job. I just know that we had also talked about the next steps to explore a drug testing program, and it wasn't listed on there, so we want to make sure that we had on there. There were no actions, it was just more discussion about the drug testing program at RHS. It could be added to the study session.
Would it be appropriate to mention RHS and RMS? Probably.
Oh,
the
yeah. Sure. Oh, which makes sense.
Any other additions or corrections? I need a motion to approve with the stated corrections.
So moved. I move to accept the minutes as corrected.
Okay.
And I'll second.
Second by Lisa. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carries 6-0. Financial report, Sherry.
Okay. Claims for approval tonight start with number 6,570 and go to 6,711, totaling $1,107,831.46. And I know some people might think that's large, but that also puts in your payroll deductions where we collect money from the employees for their insurance and stuff and send it out. So I don't want anybody to be alarmed by that, the number. We had three payrolls. Payroll 319.15 was for $324.52. We had a payroll on 3/20/15 for $391.75. Payroll on 4/3/15 was for $396,407.02. And then to compare our fund balance reports from a year ago, our general fund last year was $1,063,427, and currently it's $1,184,353. Our debt service last year was $1,524,071. Current is $1,523,479. Capital projects last year was $124,013. Currently, it is negative $50,652. Transportation last year was $611,707. Currently, it's $724,357. Bus replacement last year was $209,267. Currently, it's $179,479. Our self-insurance fund last year was negative $12,239, and currently is $273,825. Any questions?
For the public, the capital projects fund is at a negative balance right now, but I assume there will be appropriations coming shortly, so it's not negative?
Yeah, we get appropriated in June and in December.
So it's just a matter of timing more than anything,
yes.
Right?
And that, remember last year that were approved like $300,000 less on capital projects.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, motion to approve the financial funds report.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Sandy, second by Brad. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, we'll move on to student stakeholder focus donations. We have three that just come in. I'll read them first. Columbia is receiving a check for $50 for the Reading Counts program from Solar Design. And we have $300 from John Neville and Sandy Van de Bosch for the RHS Vocal Music Program. The American Legion posts $200 to the National Junior Honor Society for the Washington, D.C. trip. For the RHS prom photo booth, Rochester Telephone Company, $200. Team Pride, $150. Rochester Greenhouse, $150. For National Honor Society, Riley Hospital. Snipes, $100. Fincher & Fincher, $25. An anonymous $100 donation. For the RMS student field trips, RMS student sports helpers, $150. RMS National Honor Society Washington DC field trip, Riddle Box Top for Education, donated $100. RMS RHS Libraries, the Jennifer Kingery Obermeyer Memorial Fund, $350 to each. Columbia Students Family Dollar, donated 140 packages of cookies. And RMS Lynn Arnett's class, Walmart donated 15 bags of cypress mulch. several donations. Any questions? And if not, motion to approve donations.
A motion to approve the donations is written.
Okay, motion by Lisa.
I second that.
Second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, Dan Bailey, a Riddle social study recommendation.
This year, our textbook adoption is social studies, and part of the process and the policy is for teachers to take parents and a stakeholder group through the process and show them the different opportunities that exist for adoption. And then the final step in this will be to present to the board the committee's recommendation and have the board ask any questions and then either move to accept the program that is being presented. I know the middle school is continuing to work on their adoption process, and we should be bringing that to you next month. Part of the problem, I think, was the customer service on some of the books and textbooks, and that's kind of a good indication that maybe we shouldn't be going there if we're not getting that customer service to answer the questions. So still looking at middle school.
All right. We, in the fourth grade, have been looking at a digital textbook for social studies for most of this year. This textbook is called Crossroads Connect, and it's made by Ball State University. And probably the biggest thing that has pushed us to really look at this is it is made according to our state standards. So, you know, it's not a national product that was made by an Indiana school based on Indiana standards. So if you look at, like, this standard is our civics and government, and 4.2.3 is identify and explain major responsibilities of the branches. So then, you know, chapter 11 right here is basically everything straight from our state standards. So from a working standpoint, this is a really easy book to work with. It's completely interactive. Works just like a textbook. Kids scroll through. Has a read to me feature.
Chapter 11, civics and government.
So when you have
lesson one,
kids
the
that
Indiana
struggle reading or with reading comprehension,
all the laws
have read
in Indiana
to them,
are based on a document called the Indiana State Constitution.
Whenever they need to, vocabulary terms, completely interactive, they pop up. It's got all kinds of additional things. You know, this is just like a regular textbook with pictures and captions, except the captions pop up and, you know, it gives you discussion questions to go through with the classroom. One of the really neat features is there's a lot of audio, people speaking to you. Like, this lesson was all about the branches of government, and then they have a song. For elementary schools, music is really important, so kids learn this stuff by listening to stuff like this.
Three branches on the government tree for dividing their...
Okay, so awesome. It goes through all the branches of government, and you know, if they don't learn it from listening to me, I won't sing it to them. I can sing it to them. Really interactive pictures, all from the state. Everything goes right back to our state standards. Vocabulary. Sometimes they have hyperlinks. So you click on Thomas Marshall and it pulls up the Indiana website. So if you're doing research and you want kids to go learn more about him, you know, that's right there for them. At the end of the chapters, oh, this is something else that I like. They have these videos where they interview people. And
what laws really are is a set of rules that all of us have agreed to use in living with each other. We do experience this at first in
So all of these things are, they're part of this digital textbook, and it's downloaded on the kid's iPad, so it's not web-based. You know, this, once it's on there, you know, wherever their iPad is, they can get on their textbook and get everything, just like they would a paper book. At the end of the chapters, there are little quizzes. I want to come back to this in a minute. But this is, while I'm here, this is a really good page that they have in most of the chapters. They pick a topic, and then they kind of open it up for debate, and they have some fourth grade students on here. So you've got a pro and a con, and this one is about school vouchers.
I believe that the Indiana school voucher program is constitutional. Schools are still equally open to students.
Okay, so they have kids present one side.
In fact,
and then
the new,
you go back and you push the con tab, and it's a different student giving the other side of it. So that opens up lots of classroom discussion. Now it's hard to get that just from a regular textbook. This is a quiz at the end of every chapter. So just on their own, they can go through and review. And if they click the right answer, they get feedback right away. If they click the wrong one, you know, they know that too. So that's really how every chapter is set up. We've got a glossary with all the major vocabulary words that have pull-ups. So it really works like a textbook, but it's interactive and it's audio and it's visual and really engaging for the kids. We're really excited about it and ultimately hope it gets approved, because the kids that I've shared it with really like it, and the parents that I've shared it with really like it. The major concern that has been brought up with parents is the uncertainty of whether or not iPads are coming home with kids or not, because they're, right now they're not at the elementary school. So I've had a couple parents ask, you know, my student takes a little longer to do work or misses a day of school, how are you going to handle the makeup work? And we don't really feel that's an issue. We make accommodations and changes to plans all the time. So that's going to be something that has to be an ongoing discussion. But as far as we can see, the pros far outweigh any cons that might come up. So anybody have any questions about what this can do? Or
does it have maps? I'm a big map fan. Does it have maps in the book?
You could have asked me that question before we were I don't think there is a separate Atlas section. But there are, let's see what this, I would think within each chapter, so you ask me a question I can't answer. I don't think there is a separate Atlas section.
Okay.
No.
I guess you can go to the web for that from your iPad.
But also remember, we're talking about Indiana history, so any maps probably would be how the territory was divided early, and then what statehood looked like early. So,
what is the name of this again?
Crossroads Connect.
And I'm assuming that this is on the state's approved list. Do they still make a list to?
Yes. This is something. This is on there too, but this is kind of interesting, all the partners that they had making it. I mean, it's all the people you would want involved in your textbook. So we've got Connor Prairie and the Idle George, and we got DNR and Indiana Historical Bureau, Indiana Historical Society. So all the major Indiana State Museum, State Library, they were all involved in making it. So it's pretty widely accepted throughout Indiana. All the right people worked on it, I guess.
I noticed too when I was flipping through that they have, since they worked with all of those people in Indiana, one of the battles of the Civil War they talked about is the same one that they talk about at Connor Prairie.
Right.
So if that's a field trip you choose to take again, that's a connection right. that they have right there. Do you see a realignment of your scope and sequence or of your curriculum with this, or would you of course have to do that with any new textbook that you would?
Well, with any textbook, that happens, but we're excited about this because when you use a textbook that is produced for masses, figuring out how to use it in such a small amount of time in an elementary school day is a, you know, sifting through what is necessary and what's not is a huge deal. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of done. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, there isn't any extra unnecessary stuff in there. It's pretty well designed around the state standards. So as long as our friends in Indianapolis don't change things too much,
yeah.
things should be pretty good.
I like this a lot. I like the interaction.
That's the one, the audio and the yeah. the video, that's the biggest thing, the biggest part of the feedback that I've gotten from kids is that, you know, sitting and reading a social studies textbook for 9 and 10 year olds is pretty tough. But when they get to watch people on a video and they get to see other fourth grade kids start discussions, then it makes it a little more tolerable, I guess.
It starts to make it entertaining, the interactive part of it, so it's easier to stay focused, I believe.
And the way that they learn songs.
See, they're crossing they different subjects there, increasing the music and the art side of it, too.
This is obviously just fourth grade, so will third and fifth come? I mean, I know you're not in charge of third and fifth. But.
I've been asked, and I've made it very clear that I have no idea about anything other than fourth grade. But I have continued, you know, we had our technology meeting, and I just encourage people to keep looking because we just kind of accidentally stumbled upon this. And we stumbled upon it because we were looking. And we looked at a lot of other stuff that wasn't very good. So.
Brian, do you know are third and fifth looking to adopt another, or are they going to continue with what they have?
They're going to continue with what they're using. But one nice thing to understand is probably the most widely changed textbooks that we have in schools are social studies textbooks, except our Indiana history is not going to change. So this is something that students are going to be able to use. And if you remember in fifth grade, that's when our students are tested on social studies for ISTEP. So they will have this next year, if this is approved, our fourth grade would have this before they step into fifth grade, which they take the social studies on ISTEP. I want to applaud Mr. Bailey and the fourth grade staff for finding this. He's been in touch with the person who's put this together at Ball State. I even found out about this through Mr. Bailey even before holiday break. He was excited about it. So I really enjoyed it. He told me just a little bit ago that he was off of Wi-Fi and was able to do all the things that he needed to do, not hooked up to any internet. So he was doing that this afternoon.
And last week, I had a little bit of a panic attack because I knew I was coming here, and so I open it up to start testing it out, and nothing worked. And so I called Mr. McCarthy, and we worked on it. It turned out there was just an update. So just like you update apps every once in a while, you know, they make updates to how it works, or they put a new button in or a new song or something, and they just send an update. So just like we have to update the apps on the iPads, you know, we just update the book, and it's there.
How does the cost compare to the traditional textbooks?
It's $9.99 per book, per kid, per year. So we kind of figured out for 6 years it'd be $60, 7 years it'd be $70. So it's definitely not as expensive as a traditional textbook. Anything else? All right, well, feel free to email me or call me if you have any questions about it. And I will either tell you the answer or I'll find the answer and get it to you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank
nice
you.
Presentation.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any other questions? I'll take a entertain a motion to approve the recommendation for the social studies crossroad connection.
I move to accept Mr. Bailey's recommendation for a new social studies book.
And I'll second it.
Okay, motion by Lisa, second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Motion carried, 6-0.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you. Okay. We have a consideration of the Chemistry 2 out-of-state field trip.
Adam, do you want to share any information about that?
Yes, field trips for the Chemistry 2 class. They're going to the Cook Nuclear Power Plant in Bridgman, Michigan, which is about 20 minutes south of St. Joe, right on Lake Michigan. Goes along with what they're studying in their curriculum right now, and that power plant has a specific program for high school students to come in and do activities there throughout the day. It's about an hour and a half drive from Rochester.
This is something they've done before, isn't it? Have they done this before?
Part of why we need to bring it to you is we're taking kids across the state line, so we want to make sure everybody's aware we're going to bring them back.
The trip is on May 6th. There will be 9 students and 1 staff. Any other questions? Motion to approve the field trip?
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
I second that.
Second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carried 6-0. Information and analysis. Consideration of the running club open swim charter.
As we began having those discussions, one of the things that the board asked for was the charter for the running club to fit the policy that we have in place and to continue to make sure that we're consistent with that policy as we rent out the facility. So I think Stephanie Brown is here to talk about how the open swim nights are going and successes or concerns and then to help with any questions regarding the charter policy that was filled out.
We've had 2 open swims so far, Monday and Wednesday nights from 6 to 8, and we've had, you know, just under 30 people there both times. So we've had great success so far and a lot of good feedback from the people that have attended. So it's going really well so far.
Any questions?
You want us to keep doing it?
That is part of the feedback we've gotten from a lot of people.
Me too, but I just want to hear you say.
Yeah, that they wish that it would happen year-round, or at least, you know, a big chunk of the year.
And you're charging $4. I mean, you set out a whole $4, or there's weekly passes, or a season, your season pass.
And yeah, we just did, you know, like a 10-session pass, and a lot of people have purchased those. So.
Stephanie, can you explain that? Because RTC is according to that. Oh. They really watch this. So it's $4 per individual session.
Yes.
Or it's so much. Could you explain to us what, you get a discount for going for a whole time, right?
Yeah, we have a 10-session pass for $35. Or if you've signed up for the triathlon, it's $30. And then we offer a family discount where if you have over 2 people, we just charge half price for additional family members after that. So no one has to come as a family and spend, you know, $20 to swim. So.
What hours is it? 6 to 8 Monday and
6
Wednesday?
6 to 8 on Monday and Wednesday, yeah.
Stephanie, what's the makeup been? Has it been mostly students, mostly community members?
Varied. About half and half. Students and a lot of people training for the triathlon, but also people that just want some exercise. So, I mean, we've had people in their 60s down to high school kids, so, and a 3rd grader. I will say, this might be
nitpicky, but I know that we asked for them to fill out a charter. But reading the charter again, I don't know if it was necessary or not, because part of the charter says all participants must be RCSC students, which we knew from the beginning that that's not what this was intended. I'm very glad that the community is going. I hope that that's how it's continued to be used. But I appreciate that they filled out the charter. I will just go back to that was kind of an in-between, because they're not, like when the soccer team, before they became school sponsored, that was the Rochester soccer right. team, you know. Or even like Brad talked about with youth football, but this is different. Glad it's going.
Do you anticipate numbers during the summer months to be down a little bit?
We anticipate after the triathlon is over that the numbers will go down some, but we're just going to kind of wait until the end of May and kind of ask people that are coming, do you intend to keep coming, or are you done and the triathlon's over? And Jana and I said that, you know, we would sit down at the end of May and chat and figure it out, so.
Well, and being here now with that on RTC, I think that'll help your advertisement quite a bit too, so.
Any other questions? Thank you.
And the Sentinel. I don't want to forget you, Christina.
Oh, they already ran it.
I know they did, but.
Okay. Open to consideration of the swim club charter. Motion?
So moved.
Maybe we should correct it.
We have corrections.
Honestly, there's a typo on it. I'm getting an editor's fit out.
Well, that's the question.
Which is not.
We want an open community. It's a community resource in my mind, and I'm only one voice here, but this is a community resource the community could use. So do we need to make that amendment to it to do that, or is that something we want to do as a board or not?
Just correct it and approve it next month.
I think because what it was is that my understanding is that the traditional charter was set out in the last few years was just to so we had just a simple piece of paper for organizations that were using the building that were mainly RCSC students, but I don't know.
That's exactly what it was, so we knew who was doing what when.
Right. So should we correct it on here or just?
Which page was that?
I'm not sure it's incorrect because I think the running club are students. It's just like the youth football is there, but they let the parents also come. So the running club is the responsible party here, and they're the ones that are handling the open swim. So I'm not sure it's a complication that we need to worry about. Is that right, Stephanie? The running club are your students?
Yes, and yeah. It's run by the staff of the school.
Yeah, the three teachers, Scott, yourself, and Al.
I guess for me, the difference was that, like, for the football, they don't have the moms and dads coming out playing football with them. Or they didn't when I was around, thank goodness.
Brad does.
No, Brad doesn't. Brad's retired.
But I'm fine with leaving it as it is, except for it's not co-curricular. No. Oh, okay. But that was just something to say.
So you want to see that changed?
If it doesn't take away from the intent,
that typo is not a serious problem. So.
I'll move to accept the charter, and then maybe we can get it fixed for future use.
Right. Let's keep it going. Give me
Okay, first by Lisa and second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Motion carried, 6-0. Now we have the Rochester Royals agreement. This is same as it's been in the past.
I believe it's the same information, just dates and times have been changed, and we've just, quite honestly, I just got it from Mr. Held and we started working then on dates and times, so I don't think anything has changed. It's just a continuance of the contract that has been in place in the past.
In 2013, in order to keep the pool open, it was requested that we come up with an agreement between the Royals and the school corporation, because typically in the summer, the pool would be shut down. So that was it's basically the same agreement as we used in 2013. Obviously last summer we weren't able to have an agreement because we didn't have a pool. The only thing that would change were the dates
And then at that time, we were doing the open swim, which now the running club is doing. So we eliminated all that out of the agreement too, because we're not doing that in charge of the open swims anymore. So a separate entity from the running club, what you just discussed with them. So it's basically the same agreement as before.
Okay. Any other questions about the Oilers agreement? Motion to approve.
So moved.
Motion by Jenny.
Second.
Second by Brad. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, we have the first reading of the retention promotion policy.
The policy is number 5410 under promotion, placement, and retention. And Tammy, if you want to jump in at any point in time, but part of what we want to make sure is happening are the teachers, administrators that are having those tough conversations with parents. And sometimes we were finding in the past, if a student was placed into the next grade, that meant that they were borderline, that we were under the assumption that they were going to catch up, and that wasn't always the case. And so sometimes those conversations became more difficult, and we really want this to be a joint effort between teachers, administrators, parents, everybody to sit down at that common table and have those discussions if we're going to place a student into the next grade level. So on policy 5410, what we are proposing is near the bottom, the second part, the superintendent may develop administrative guidelines for promotion, placement, and retention of students, which under letter A, we would like to put require that parents are informed in advance of the possibility of retention and placement of a student at a grade level so that they understand the retention and or placement of the student. And then there are forms that would be filled out documenting to keep in their file. Also, these are conversations that we could also have in the pivot program where we're trying to track all of the data and interventions in one place as well.
I do have a question. Will there be a definition of what promotion, placement, and retention is? Because I know the current policy, it does address promotion, it does address placement or promotion and retention, but it didn't necessarily say what a placement is. So is that going to be part of the new policy?
We can write that. It's not written into this one as it is now.
Okay. I think that would be very beneficial and help provide clarity not only to administrators and teachers, but to parents as well as when we're having those conversations.
So basically the definition of what placement will be.
Yeah, I can work on that. Or the policy committee can work on that.
I do have things that I can share. Like,
sure, go ahead.
No, I meant.
Oh, you mean in regards to wording and?
From the order.
Okay.
The definition. What we currently use at least.
Any questions on the first reading? Okay. Duke Energy Grant.
Tim, do you want to talk about?
This is very exciting.
You should each have a copy of the grant as well.
I had received a phone call right, it must have been 2 days before spring break from Duke Energy asking if Columbia would be interested in applying for a grant, and she apologized and said, but it's due in 2 days. But if we, after speaking to Mrs. Sheets, it seemed like it was such an amazing opportunity for our kiddos at the elementary, both Columbia and Middle Impact, the kids that are going to third grade at Riddle. It just seemed like something that we needed to get busy and try to do. The funds for this grant that Duke had set aside was very specific. It had to be used towards a summer remedial reading program. That's what your grant had to be developed around. So you should have all the components that are in bold, or the components that the grant required.
Just in summary, the Summer Remedial Literacy Program will meet every Monday and Wednesday from 9:45 to 11:15, and that may extend to 11:30 depending on food service. We'd like to be able to give those kiddos a nice warm lunch because Columbia is the summer feeding program comes out of Columbia during the summer, so it'd be nice that we can send those kids out the door with a full belly. It would start June 8th and it would go through July 29th with the exception of the week of intercession. We would anticipate that the students that will be recommended for this program will probably also be the students that we'd recommend for intercession, so we'd like to not take that away from them. The student selection will come from this year's first graders and this year's second graders. So the kids going into second grade and the kids going into third grade are the students that would be chosen for this program. We're looking at the grant was written that we would have six teachers and each teacher would have approximately five students that they would work with. We have them just for a very short amount of time. We wanted to make sure that time was very intense. And it was an intensive, concentrated effort on the reading of those students. The grant, you can read how they're going to be progress monitored. And part of the grant was that we would have a family recognition night held at the end, and then there was funds set aside for that. The budget is also listed. We received notification. So last week,
I think so.
That our grant has been funded as a whole. So the corporation received $8,950 from Duke Energy to provide this summer reading program. This will serve as a tier two intervention for our RTI process, which is awesome that it's another level of support that we can give those students to help as they develop their reading skills. So. I don't know. Do you have any questions?
Well, Tammy, you answered one of mine because I looked at that and thought 30 students, six teachers, really? But a 1-5 ratio.
1-5 ratio is what I was thinking. When I thought about the model, I kind of in my mind when I was writing the grant, I was thinking about our Title I reading teachers and the model that they use in their classroom, and that's how I kind of envision this program working over the summer. Mac has given a couple of my teachers access to the
Lexia.
We're having some hiccups, but they're trying that because I do think that would be another good resource that we could use when they're doing their reading groups. I've also, this is the time of year that the public library comes to Columbia and they do a lot of programs. And last week I met with them and said, if we would by chance have a summer reading program, how could we partner with you and how could we use their resources and their programming and getting our kids involved with, because they already have so many neat guest speakers involved in hands-on activities, that how can we piggyback on that and maximize all the resources that we have available. And they were very excited about that.
So to synopsize, Mondays and Wednesdays, you're going to have 30 first and second grade kids that need help reading, and Duke's going to pay for it and feed them.
Mm-hmm. Well, the food we have the free food,
right?
The summer, but yeah, they're going to provide us. Even I wrote into the grant a reimbursement for some transportation and fuel costs to cover. We don't want transportation to be a barrier for our kids. One thing that I don't know if it's in the grant or not. I think it is. I want to be very selective in the students that are going to be offered this opportunity, and then I want there to be some accountability on the parents, because if I only can offer it to 30 kiddos, I want to know that those 30 kids are going to be there and they're going to be there religiously on time, you know, that this is going to be a priority in their summer. So I was thinking of a contract between the student and the parent and the teacher and even Duke. They want to be involved in this. They want to come and to the recognition programs. They want to come and visit during the summer. They want to be actively involved in this. And so I think it's exciting and encouraging as well, just to build that community connection.
And I see that there's a stipend for the administrative coordinator. So I assume that person will be there every day that the program is offered then?
Not necessarily every day. There will be an adult there. There will be an administrator there. The coordinator position, if you read the description, is mainly the to help develop the program, to help document the program, to help and then provide the data at the end of the program. That's the main goal of that. And there is, I don't know, we had part of the grant process is we had to write job descriptions for everything. Did you have those? And so those are in there as well.
Okay. Thank you, Tammy. I know a lot of effort and time goes into grants and really appreciate that.
Thank you.
It's going to be great for the kids that really need the help. So thank you. Any other questions for Tammy? Okay. Okay, the F1 application update.
In the past, Tricia Setterholm had brought to us the desire to apply for an F1 application, and there was a student who was interested in attending here. Now that student has decided not to move forward with that, so I need some direction from the board as to whether or not we want to go ahead and try to become an F1 school so that if this happens in the future, we are ready to go, because part of the process, part of where I believe we're losing some of these students is in the process. It takes 6 to 9 months to complete. And that time, once the family's decided that they want to continue here, then we are not in a position to go ahead and move forward in a timely manner. So just some direction from the board. Part of what we had agreed upon in the past is that this student and family would absorb the cost of the application fee, which to the best of my knowledge is a $1,500 application fee. And then there's a $600 site visit fee that we would incur. As well as the time to pull all of this together. So at this point, if we decided to move forward, it would be a cost that the school would need to absorb. Then we would be geared up for students in the future if we would like to have this program in place.
What's your recommendation?
I think it could be beneficial moving forward. I mean, we've lost two students who potentially could have continued on here, and I think that just as we talked about in the past, it's a benefit to both us and to those students.
But this says that the parents would absorb that cost. What would happen if we go ahead and put that in place?
We would have to absorb that cost.
And what would that cost be?
$2,100
per student?
This is just for the application.
Oh, for the just application, a one-time cost.
$1,500 application fee and then a $600 site visit fee that gives us feedback on our curriculum and those types
and
of things.
And that is a one-time cost.
A one-time cost.
And then after that, any student that wanted to take advantage of that, they pay tuition. Sure.
Right, they exactly. would cover their whole cost.
They would cover the cost, for them to be here.
But we would not lose them then anymore because of the time constraints, the 6 to 9 months it takes to process this. Mm-hmm.
Is there possibly we wouldn't be approved after spending the site visit money?
I don't anticipate that. I think that we're geared up well for it. I'm sure that it possibly could, but reading the criteria, I'm confident we could do this.
Did Don think we applied for this previously, like years ago? Did we ever uncover that?
We cannot find any documentation. I know it was a discussion in the past, and we lost that student too because of the time constraint. By the time they decided that they wanted to attend, and then the 6 to 9 month processing and on-site visit, it hindered that student wanting to attend because that would have put them here like in November or December or something. And so,
I think it was just, it never got past the discussion point.
Right.
I think so. We could also pass on part of that charge in the future to students that come, just add $100 or $200 to every student that you're paying for our application that we did a few years ago, and eventually we'd recoup it.
Don was the one who had done more research on this, but I think even he had mentioned that the site fee was waivable for certain criteria. So we might
not. I wasn't able to find it.
You weren't able to find it. Oh,
but,
I like that.
But if we can find it, we most certainly will.
Yeah, I don't know what his documentation was.
Any other discussion, comments, questions?
The policy was to go forward with it.
With the family and
the modification now is because of the cost will be borne by the school corporation, but Janet can handle that. So as long as you're comfortable with it, I think she can go from here.
Yeah, we can move forward if you'd like. And then we'll be prepared in the future.
Well, I think it's a good idea for that reason alone, that if somebody wants to do it again, at least we're ready for it, instead of taking.
Right, we can be proactive instead of reactive.
Right.
Okay.
Well, open for a motion.
I move that we go forward with the F1 application and that the school will pay the administrative or the application fee.
And I'll second it.
Motion by Jenny and second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please.
Thank you.
Motion carried 6-0. The memorandum of understanding, yep. Weather-related makeup time.
This is just, it's in your packet. It's just the agreement with the Teachers Association and implementing the extended day times. It outlines the dates and the times that we have already implemented. High school and middle school from 7:45 to 3:35, and elementary schools from 8 until 3:15. And it's just those one of those contractual things we need to do with them. And I think it's been running well and going smoothly. And we're down to, 26, 28 days to make up. And then we've got this one under our belt. So I think we're close to getting it done and getting our time in. So it's just an agreement that we need the board to be in with on this.
Did we ever hear anything definitive about whether the state had decided that we might have to make up 2-hour delays?
No, but let's not jinx it. We're fine. We're not talking delays. We're not talking cancellations. We are just going to school.
Can you entertain a motion on the memorandum?
All right. I move to ratify the weather-related makeup time as it's already been implemented.
Okay. Motion by Lisa.
I second that.
Second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carried 6-0.
And a sincere thank you to those who filled out the survey. I think we had 1,100 people respond to that survey. And there was some really good input, not only for this particular, to address this particular problem, but moving forward with e-learning and extended days and all of that. So it gave us a lot of information that we weren't necessarily looking for, but it'll be beneficial as we move forward this summer into some planning portions. So
thank you. Get a chance to read every one of those comments.
Okay. I've read a lot of them.
I read all of them.
Okay.
Late night entertainment.
Yes, ma'am.
I am so appreciative of all the people that do take the time.
Yes.
To fill those out. It has really, over the years, it has really changed, I think, our, you know, concerns and
just, it gives us input on behalf
does,
of them.
Absolutely, so what people think, you know, and how they think we're doing, so.
And there were some great ideas that came out that we'll be discussing this summer, so.
Okay. Moving on to the personnel report. We have the, you had your packet the list of the spring coaching recommendations. Hiring of Jared Smith, payroll HR specialist. Hiring of Kathy Watson, Riddle special needs instructional assistant. Hiring of Felinga Jackson, kindergarten instructional assistant for maternity leave. Hiring of Julia Faust Fuller, RMS teacher maternity leave. And we have resignation Molly Crottier, instructional assistant in life skill room at the middle school. Then we also have some intercession notes of Joanna Johnson, Riddle teacher. Bethany Sewell was previously approved for that position. And Julia Kitchell, Riddle instructional assistant. We'd missed her on the last personnel report.
Johnson is Columbia.
Columbia? Oh, okay. Make that correction. Okay, any questions? If not, I'll need a motion to approve the personnel report.
So moved.
Motion by Sandy.
I'll second.
And second by Jenny. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries 6-0.
Jared Smith is here, our new HR person. Jared, do you want to take a few minutes just to introduce yourself and maybe talk a little bit about your past and your family? And he's been trying to keep all of us ladies in line and realizing that's a full-time job in itself.
Well, I'm Jared Smith. I came from First Farmers Bank and Trust previously in the HR department. I did a lot of their recruiting, staffing. Previously, I graduated from Indiana Tech out of Fort Wayne. the bachelor's in 2008. I live here locally. We moved here last summer, my wife and my daughter. It's me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jared. Thank you, and welcome.
Jared, I know you have a young one at home. If you want to, you're welcome to go. Okay, all right.
Okay, move on to the weather-related employee pay.
When we started missing school, there were several who brought to my attention that in the past, Dan Ronk had tried to compensate at some level some of those positions, and there was also a lot of discussion that in some of our handbooks it says that that's not needed, and so there was a lot of discussion, and I think it was very insightful, and as we move forward with the possibility of e-learning days, as we look at maybe changing our calendar a bit to absorb some more of those school-related delays and cancellations, I need people to be prepared that in the future this is not going to happen. I mean, this is a past practice that we're trying to make right with employees, but moving forward, I don't believe that this is going to be a necessity. If we update our handbooks where they need to be, if we're implementing a new e-learning system, if we're looking at our calendar, I don't foresee this being a concern in the future. But then I know that there was a lot of discussion about making sure we treated employees right and compensating them where we needed to, and they couldn't help that we missed the day. So I want to commend Sherry and Linda. They spent a lot of time trying to get some information and data gathered as well. So what we are proposing is, to the best of our knowledge, and I want to be very clear that we know we're not getting minute for minute, hour for hour on some of these things. This is the best faith effort to try to make this right for this year, and then we'll make sure that we're communicating better in the future what that might look like. But for bus drivers, we figured that there were 6 days missed. The average rate is $70. That would be $420 per driver from the transportation fund. We have 17 drivers at $420, so we would incur $7,140 out of the transportation fund. Food service missed 6 days last year. Six days missed this year. An average of 6 hours a day at $9 an hour. That's $324 per employee from the food services fund. At 24 employees, that's $7,776. Kudos to Kathy Wilkinson and to Sherry. Last year at this time, we were not able to offer that because we honestly didn't know where that budget was, and that's something that they worked diligently to make sure that we do have a budget in place and we know where we are in that. And so hopefully that is an attempt to make that right with the food service. We have 2 extended day employees. Those are the ladies who stay after school with the extended day program. 6 days missed at 2 hours a day at $9 an hour. That's $108 for those 2 IAs for the extended day employees at $216. Instructional assistants were very, very difficult to figure out because they are already gaining some time at the beginning and the end of the days with the students that they're working with. So we figured the 6 days at about an hour and a half of time mass. The rest of that time is being taken care of with the extended hours that they're working. So at $9 an hour, that's $81 per employee. We have 63 IAs. The total cost would be $5,103, knowing that that's going to come from different funds, partly from general fund, some from special education, some Medicaid, some transportation, depending upon specifically what the IA's jobs, what they're hired for, and specifically where they fall. And again, best faith effort to try to pull this together for everybody, but as we move forward and we make those additions and update handbooks, look at calendar, I anticipate this being the last year that we'll need to go through this process.
Any questions?
This also, I need to state, we would not pay this until the first pay period in June.
So first sure that they've made it through all the days of school.
We want to make sure, partly too, we've had this happen in the past, not a lot, but those employees that stay with us through the remainder of the school year and then award that on June 1st. It's difficult to
to say, but sometimes you write these checks and then they decide to resign 2 or 3 days later, and we want to make sure they're just as committed to us as we are to making this right for them. So we would issue that the first pay period in June.
Well, thank you, Jan, and thank you, Sherry. I think it's important we treat our people right, at least from my perspective. So,
yes.
Thank you.
What do we do if we have another this day? For some reason.
We won't.
Just shut the cameras off for a minute.
It's not in the works, no.
We would, it's honestly, if we miss, if we have a delay, my understanding is we have to go back and we have to make up that time. So what we would essentially be doing is going back and revisiting how many days are left, how much time. I would anticipate we would have to make that up the first day of June. Whether or not that would take some time off of where we already are because of the way we're making that up, there would be a fine formula there that we would have to figure out to make sure that we're paying, making that time up. But if we miss for any reason, delay or cancellation, we will be looking at that first makeup day in June. We're not going there.
Thank you, Linda.
Jan, am I to understand, I've been doing the calculations here, this is a little over $20,000 to the corporation?
To various funds.
But district-wide, it's costing us over $20,000.
And last year, we did just the bus drivers at $10 a day. And so
IAs, we added half an hour a week.
But that's a fraction of the $20,000. So this isn't really the precedent that was set last year.
The food service, they were not able to. There was discussion around that, but they were not able to because of the budget. And then there was some, it caused a little bit of a hardship, conflict between employees when you're trying to work together as a district to view some entities as getting paid, others as not, those types of things. It really created a bit of an unrest. So we want to make sure if we're going to do this, we need to do it right, knowing that in the future, because of the cost, because of the handbook's not being updated and it needs to be, knowing that we need to look at e-learning, I hated to cause that unrest. We talked about treating employees right, and it's difficult. We toss this around a lot.
I think there's a fine line between treating employees right, I'm full supporter of that, to paying people for time, hourly employees for time that they didn't spend working.
Exactly.
And I think that's a very slippery slope. That is a concern.
Sure.
That's the nature of that.
Right.
You know, that pay scale. That's how that happens when you're working hourly.
And I really appreciate the work that was done to develop this proposal by Sherry and Linda and yourself and others. And I definitely appreciate the work done by all of our IAs and food service and transportation and all of the people who work so hard in our district. But I'm concerned that the proposal is full repayment. That's the nature of an hourly job. And even if it's not specifically spelled out in the handbook, that's the nature of an hourly job. And sometimes hours get cut. When hours get cut other places, usually those aren't replaced. I know that it wasn't our fault because of the weather. Nobody wanted this. But I'm concerned about the level. I would be fine with a stipend as an understanding that this was a hardship. But I think this goes way above that, especially if last year it was a small stipend. And I understand I wouldn't want to do it just for one group.
Right.
Again, I get that. But then to say, we'll do full repayment. And then next year, if we miss days or we have e-learning days, so we're not needing food service or we're not needing transportation, we won't pay you at all. I don't see the consistency.
I think part of it was looking for communication for those employees to better prepare moving forward as well.
And at this point, this is the last time, one time. In the future, it won't set a precedent.
No, I don't want this to, no. We need to update those handbooks. We need to communicate to employees. They need to understand that this will be the last time that this is going to happen. And I would feel better having that as a policy in the handbook.
I don't think we can refer to it so much, or I'm a little bit uncomfortable with referring to it as the last time, considering it would also be the first time, because we didn't do this last year. We missed as many days, I think, or close. And we didn't do this last year. So I feel like we went from not doing it to now we're going to, this is a full repayment, and then next year we're not going to do it again. So I don't, as Jenny said, I concur. There's just no continuum there. I think that's a large expenditure for the district on something that wasn't, work that wasn't done.
Yeah, I agree with both of you. I mean, the nature of the job, I mean, unfortunately, you didn't get to work that day, but people in other jobs are the same way.
Well, and even by our decisions, people in other jobs probably missed their work because it's not our fault for the weather, but if we canceled and they have an hourly job but they needed to stay home with their student, we're not going out and saying, well, now we'll repay you for that. I mean, that's just the nature of it.
Any other comments, questions?
I have two questions. So does this affect our budget? So we budgeted a certain amount for salary and pay, and then because of the missed days, we actually paid less. So overall, our budget won't be impacted. Is that right, Sherry?
That is correct. If you had the 6 days, you'd still be paying it. All our missed days were in 2015, they weren't in 2014. So it's all in the current budget year.
And the second question, so if we wanted to talk about this more in a study session, would there be time to bring it up in the May meeting and then still pay it in June if the board wanted to do that? Mm-hmm. Is there any urgency or is it necessary that it has to pass tonight?
No, there's no urgency.
I'd like some more time to think on after hearing some views like that. Myself.
And yeah, I think another, wait another month, and maybe if there's public input out there, like your views too.
Sure. I'm thankful that the intention is to take good care of our employees, and I think that everybody here wants that, and I appreciate that that's what you were looking to do.
Okay.
Yep, we can do that, most certainly.
So Tom, you'll table it until the next meeting?
Yes, we'll table that until the main meeting. Then.
That way the minutes can reflect what happened.
Okay, thank you, Ted. Okay, we have an employee concern.
I think Mr. Bill Nicholson wanted to speak to the board.
Okay. I'll come up here so I can hear you better. Maybe you can hear me better. My attorney's in the back. Oh, well, actually, she's my wife and my doctor, not an attorney. But I've been driving school bus for us since about 1984 and started 2 years part-time at that time. A couple things I wanted to discuss. Primarily because we have went through a good selection of superintendents in the past few years. It seems like I'm finding myself in a situation that probably should have, for no better word, maybe gotten some resolve on my extended vacation time. I usually start that process in about the latter part of February. And because it takes a lot to do what I do, I usually leave for the opener in Canada for the walleye season, which is the third Saturday in May every year. Before I get into that, I would like to discuss probably the first portion with you because it won't take very long. When we came back last year from Canada, I had flown Patty into Winnipeg because I have to buy airline tickets, and it's nice to get those before the prices go cha-ching at the last minute. She was up there approximately 3 days, and I blew up my big engine. So that's what got me back for the staff meeting. I hadn't been to a staff meeting in years. I've been going up there for probably in excess of 25 years. When we got back, had a little surprise right after the staff meeting. We met at the administration building, and I was informed that we had implemented a new school bus driver's physical performance test. I asked what all it kind of entailed, and Michael kind of told me. There's five sections to it, and I was very apprehensive about section one. About that time, Larry Kripe came walking out of the basement of the administration building. Section one basically says, driver shall demonstrate the ability to exit the bus from the seatbelt position in the driver's seat, exiting from the rearmost emergency door, which basically meant jumping out the back door. This wasn't a timed event. The only timed event that's on this is in section two, and it talks about opening up the main door of the bus two times within 10 seconds. And because we no more have doors like this anymore, we flip a little toggle switch like most of the farmers have on their newer tractors anymore. Basically, this school bus performance test was a bill that was passed, the public law number 54-1998, by the school bus committee in 2002. So we're actually 13 years into this before we even implement it. It was also determined that the physical ability necessary for a person to be able to be a school bus driver, and it went into effect January 1, 2002. A school bus driver holding a standard certificate issued prior to January 1, 2002 is exempted from meeting these requirements, in other words, grandfathered in, as many things that came along back then before CDLs were involved and things of that nature. A lot of the guys, well, everybody was grandfathered in a lot of these things. As long as the driver attends an annual safety meeting and keeps a standard driver's license continuously renewed, that's how he got exempt. If he failed to take that annual, what we also refer to as a summer course, which doesn't necessarily have to be a summer course, this really doesn't come due till most schools that I'm aware of is in October. So anyway, section one, as I just read, I was very apprehensive, very concerned about dropping out that back door. Our fleet, I don't think we have anybody under the age of 40. Therefore, climbing the ladder of life, everybody's on the downhill slide of that ladder now. I think there's very few that we have between the ages of 40 and 55. The majority of us are 55 on up. Larry's 74, just had that new knee put in a couple years ago. A year before that, I had both my meniscus torn in my legs, and I just didn't want to hit that ground with a lot of pain, possibly taking out an ankle, a knee, my back. As it was, we did this evacuation with a newer bus, and that really did jar the back of my neck. I had the opportunity to have lunch out today, and I ran into one of our Caston school bus drivers. She'd been driving for 45 years, and she says they've implemented this, and she really cracked her head a good one. She said that was horrible. Looking at this and with communicating this with Jana on March the 9th at 9 o'clock in the morning, I also had a VA appointment at 11 o'clock that morning, and I knew that she had questions she wanted to talk to Mr. Wagner about, and I was hoping that maybe with my communication with her that we could maybe somehow implement a waiver for those people that maybe don't feel like Superman anymore and might run a good chance of getting hurt. Well, that didn't apparently work. When I was at my VA appointment, I asked my practitioner, would it be possible that you could write a little paragraph for me basically just recommending that maybe I didn't do a lot of unnecessary jumping. At that point, she handed me back a little paragraph that says, to whom concerned, Mr. Nicholson has a history of back and knee problems. Because of his back and knees, I do not recommend jumping unless it's an absolute emergency. Again, Janice, concerned, we've got to take care of these kids. We've got to know that you guys can take care of these kids. Very understandable. I come back for the PM route. I gave Michael a copy of this letter, and I asked him, would you please put this in my folder for safekeeping till next August? Because I was under the opinion that this was something that we were going to start doing every August. So I did realize that going through my files concerning my my leave time off, that this letter would even be an issue. I was hoping that it might help her to show Ted that there are some concerns about our geriatric team out there about making the leap. Come to find out, the very next day, which just so happened to be January 7th, I received this April 7th. I received this April the 8th. Basically, it says we have scheduled the driver safety exam for April the 9th, immediately after the following route in the bus lot. You should be ready to prove your fitness for that exam. So I had to do it all over again. Fortunately, I was able to do it out of the bus that I have, which is a little shorter to the ground, but I wasn't as apprehensive. You know I had the choice of either doing it or not doing it, and anyway, that's the story, and that's why I felt like, you know, we need to take a good look at these drivers. I also, in the meantime, after talking with Jana, got a hold of the president and vice president of the Indiana School Bus Association. The president of the Indiana School Bus Association is a board member on the Indiana School Bus Committee. He told me that they have real concerns for the older staff, and that was kind of the process of maybe allowing them to have that being factored in and not happening to even do this test. That kind of takes care of that. I sure would think trying to get something in there for some of these guys that might really hurt themselves for no, you know, I mean, it took us 13 years to implement this thing, so. Well, part two of what I wanted to talk to you also about was concerning my my summer vacation leave. A couple things that we had talked about on March the 9th was, again, this and my extension. Jana was mentioning, you know, we need to follow what the handbook has to say. And then going through my file, looking at what Dan Ronk had put in my file concerning my vacation time. Basically, it says, basically on page 12 in the handbook, it basically states the problem issuing regarding school bus or any school related function should be resolved through, this isn't what I want to do. It just basically said two people can't be off at the same time, preferred. Extended vacations would be discouraged, and senior staff would be looked at possibly first in the issue of the two people that would get the extended leave. Again, putting in this thing early, with next August being 32 years in for me. The closest one next to me is 16, I believe. Up until Mr. Rock became superintendent, on and about my first time, I put my leave, I did this backwards when I did. Okay, personal leave, the use of personal leave to extend vacations is discouraged. However, if needed, only two drivers may receive priority approval, and only if substitutes are available. When more than two requests are received, the two granted will be determined by the length of time driving for Rochester Community School Corporation. Number five, no more than two drivers may be allowed off at any time unless an exception is granted by the superintendent. One of the things that was put into my file, I should probably save that last. In 2012, this is kind of what the personal leave requests look like. You probably have seen them. One of the notes that Dan made in 2012, which was his first year to approve me doing this, was approved as past of past practices. Policy will be reviewed when considering all classified employees handbook. So he really allowed me that year to leave May the 16th and come back August the 20th. The following year, in 13, Dan basically states, last year request will be honored. So instead of it being discouraged, as our handbook says, he puts in here, last year request will be honored. So that's almost like saying a flat no. So I said to Sheila, I says, well, set me up for the school board and we'll discuss it then, and maybe we can have something put in my file so that we can continue on doing this project. Then in so anyway, while Janet and I are talking and sharing, I'm thinking, well, maybe it's a possibility we just don't have the subs, because I've missed two medical appointments this year because we didn't have subs. I had to come up with other ways of getting around that. The last letter in 2013 was on April the 24th, and basically says the importance of the letter, and this was written by Sheila, directed by Dan. Please note that unpaid extended time off during the school year will not be permissible in the future. It also discusses unpaid leave. Well, I don't expect to be paid when I'm in this. If I'm not working here, I don't expect to be paid. I don't expect for my pay to start till I come back to work. I don't want to be paid. I don't need to be paid while I'm gone. I know that's kind of off the cuff, but that's the process that I find myself in. Janet has denied my vacation time. I'm a little unsure as if that was pending the handbook, and if it's the handbook, I don't think that is considered discouragement. I think it's just a flat denial. Or if it was because of the lack of subs and not getting a sub, I would think that as long as there's a sub that can sit in my seat, which has never been a problem in the past 20 some years of doing this, that wouldn't be a problem. I mean, I think everybody looks at this job as a part-time job, and I think I made $11,200 last year. That's all I made. We don't have a retirement, and So that being said, I guess I would ask at this point for a little more clarity. When I got home that afternoon that you handed me that letter, thinking either you made a mistake, which had been done once before, checking in the wrong box, or it was the lack of subs, the first four people I called said that there would be no problem. They would be more than happy to sub for me in August. Other than one said, I couldn't do it the first week, but certainly could the next. I says, well, let me get further into this, and that'll all be taken care of. That's pretty much my story. I don't know if this is something you're going to vote on here while I'm here, or if you guys are going to take time to think about this. There's just a tremendous amount of things that when I first started, I was running three businesses and also finding time to drive school bus. I've shut one of my businesses down for the sole purpose so that I could leave the third week of May and be up there. I'm doing some guiding back then. I don't guide as much as I used to. I certainly am instructing kids pretty much all summer, getting them in my boat, taking them out. I've got a lot of money tied up in this thing, a lot of money. For me to replace my truck, about 60-some thousand dollars now. For me to replace my boats, $40,000 to $50,000. I have an RV that I leave up there all the time. I've got a lot of money that's sitting in Canada as we speak. This just is something that I've done and enjoyed for many years. The reason for the executive session, I really felt that this part of this is pretty private to me. And I didn't want the public finding out that I'm not home all summer. I live about 6 minutes away from here as the crow flies, 2 miles west of Jim Strader's New Holland. And I didn't want the public realizing how easy it would be to just help themselves to whatever, let alone the dangers that could happen to my wife while I'm gone. So because it's a security issue, I hope maybe we can use myself as an example. And then if an employee should happen to say, I feel strongly because of security issues of what I have invested here, maybe we could speak on a more of a private level. So thank you for your time. I wish I could have been a little more organized for you.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Oh, I should mention that Bill did ask that this conversation be held in executive session. We looked at the statute. There was no reason under the statute. It's a statute that starts out that the public's business is to be conducted in public. I understand Bill's concern about the safety issues, but you must fit into one of the niche categories that allows you to be in private. And in order for him to have qualified, Jana would have had to have taken some disciplinary action against him, and he was appealing that to the board. That has not happened, and that's basically the only way an employee comes before the board in an executive session. Part of the discussion was, is he asking for a change to the policy? And it appears from this he's not, that the, he thinks that
he gave me a packet of section 6-1 concerning the executive session, and I looked for a loophole in there to get me in that, and it didn't happen. Jan's been very helpful, and I must say over the years I probably have had a handful or less discipline problems that I've had to take to Jana when she was at the high school. I try to stay on top of what I do, and she's one of the few that were very prompt of just taking care of the situation and returning our discipline forms back on a very prompt basis. That's better than I can say for a lot of the administrators that I've had in the past, when I've had to wait as much as 6 weeks to get that paperwork back, not knowing where's the student sit as far as being able to be put back on my bus. So she's done a great job. I think she's going to do a great job here for us too. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Bill.
Any questions?
Thank you. So at this point, your recommendation, we need to time gather facts, What's your thoughts?
We have worked a lot with the transportation department in regards to that, and it does create a hardship as far as extracurricular activities. We're also talking about right now the possibility of adding additional bus routes. There's concern about the times, the length of time students are on the buses. There's concern about the amount of students on the buses and the discipline problems that arise out of that, and we're trying to work with the transportation department. We've met a couple times just recently on the thought of adding new routes, and if we are to add more routes, that's obviously going to take more drivers, and I am just really concerned about how that's going to look in the future if we have drivers taking extended leaves of time and we're adding routes, we're taking extracurriculars on at that time, and it's just a busy time of the year with students coming on board and new routes and following those processes.
I see two things here, and bringing up the one about the standards, where it does say you are exempted prior to 2002. Is it a school policy that we follow that? Is that a state law? What is that? Where he's in 2002, there's two issues here, the whole, the bus standard and then the vacation policy. So can we tackle those separately? Or
the board previous to the board setting here, we had talked about the physical fitness standards, those types of things, and we understood that drivers could be grandfathered in. I believe at that time, we can go back to the notes and check, that we felt if it was important for it to be adopted, it was important for the students, for their safety. The standards, there were five of them, and I can read through them if you like. They seem to be very basic standards. The board at that time agreed that that would be good for all drivers to go through for the safety of the students. So the state did allow for a grandfathering in. That was a minimum, if I understand, and then the board could determine if they wanted to have all drivers pass that performance standard, and that was the position that the former board took in regards to that. And there are five standards. If you'd like for me to read through those, I most certainly can.
I've read them. I'm okay. I don't know anybody else.
So that was that process. And then the second process is just the concern. I'm not exactly sure what the fall's going to look like at this point in time. And in a couple of more weeks, we'll know whether or not we can add additional routes. But in that, it does, with extracurriculars in the fall, parents calling in, confused about drivers, kids' routes, those types of things, we continually entertain that at the beginning of the year. It's just a busy time, and I would like to set that precedent moving forward, that they know the driver, they know what's going on, and we may be looking at adding additional drivers to the fleet.
Where's the fitness requirement? Maybe Michael, you can answer this. Does it require standing at the back door and jumping out, or can you sit and slide
out? You can sit. That's what they recommend.
Which would be a big difference in your knees.
So you're only about this far from, if the guy's shorter, there'll be a little more room, but yeah. That's about how much you'd be.
You can have somebody at the base of the bus, not to assist them out, but if they start to fall, to catch them for safety purposes. You can also have a mat down, correct?
That's what some states do say. But, you know, if you're in an emergency, you ain't going to have
I understand that. Yeah. I understand.
You can have that for the test.
For the test, correct. Right. I'm not expecting to go throw a mat out of our school bus racks.
Yeah, but the test is pass-fail.
Correct.
And if you can't land and be in control of the situation of the students, then you failed. And so, you know, that's the complication. But like Jim says, the state did authorize grandfathering in, and the board a few years ago said, well, we can't grandfather them in for that. It doesn't do any good to explain to a parent, well, so-and-so's been driving for, 15 years, and so your child was left on the bus.
I have to say that I do understand that we do have an aging population in our drivers, but the kids absolutely come first. And if I'm not sure that my bus driver is not going to be able to get my child out of the bus, I don't want them in the seat. If they can't pass that test, I don't want them in the seat.
And if we look at the start of the school year, beginning of the school year, every single day, and I said this to the drivers at the meeting, the bus drivers really do set the tone for the kids for the day. They are the first people that our students see at the beginning of the day. They are the last people our students see at the end of the day. And everything else in between can come null and void based on that relationship with the driver. And I think it's really important that they know their driver, that they build that relationship with the driver, and that begins with day one, building those relationships and helping them out at the beginning of the year. But I told them at that opening meeting, they play such an integral role in what we do from beginning to end. And I want to thank you gentlemen for that, because it is, and ladies that drive too, it is such an important role, and we need to continue to sustain that and build those relationships with the students.
Is one question?
I have a question for Bill. It's not too late. Bill, I've got a question for you. So what it looks like, personal leave is not used to extend vacation. So you said when you're in Canada, is that a, that's another business that you have in Canada?
Well, it certainly did cross my mind. I am not, I don't want to get in trouble with Canada again. It's something I do mostly as a hard attitude. It certainly doesn't pay for my fuel. I can tell you that when I was running hard, I could go through 40 gallons of fuel a day. That's not cheap up there. Just the gas bill is a lot more than what my camping bill is for the summer. I did just very little guiding last year, and I usually don't charge. But if they want to give me a little something, I don't stop that either.
Is that what you ask? Do you report income for what?
No.
Do you report zero income for?
Do not.
But I think, to the language within the handbook, if you're looking at page 9 under item number 4, where it says the use of personal leave takes in vacations is discouraged, I believe that what they're referring to is vacation time within the school year. And that's part of the handbook, the teachers' collective bargaining agreement, classified certified staff. We're talking about vacation time within the built-in calendar. So we're talking about not personal vacation time, but those vacation times that are within the calendar, fall break, Christmas break, spring break, summer breaks, that kind of vacation break time, for clarification.
The May, at the end of May, the third week of May, the school's out, is something that I did a lot of. But a lot of times I had done that, and I've been up there when I watched the ice melt at the 1st of June. So there's no point in me being up there. That's the more relaxed aspect of what I would be willing to give up, as I did with Dan. Didn't want to. I'd rather have the choice rather than to lock it in and then say, well, you know, I've changed my mind, which is not a tough thing to do as far as with dealing with the subs. So really I'm missing out on about a week, maybe a week and a half at the beginning of the school year in August. I can understand Janet's point, certainly. I've got Country Meadows over here, and that can be a very, very rough route. I'd even brought up the suggestion of even job sharing, and that looked like that was going to work. I'd run the morning route, have somebody do the afternoon route. That would take care of my Canada problem. He could run while I'm gone. But when I found out who I was job sharing with, this driver was very relaxed, and our personalities were so different that even when I came back, I had parents calling me and saying, gosh, are we glad you're back? Because I'm probably one of the more stern drivers in our fleet. And I think my video, if you ever watched the video, it would state that. So, yeah, as far as the business goes, I don't like to get into any more Canada government than I have to. Yeah.
The other thing is, there's nothing for the board to do. Your role is only to review an action that Jana would take. She's expressed her concerns. If Bill does what he said he wants to do, and she terminates him, then he has a right to appeal it. If he adjusts and doesn't go, then obviously nothing happens. If he goes and she doesn't terminate him, then you don't have to take any action. So.
Yep. a decision you want to make at this time, or?
I need to stand by my original decision. I mean, knowing what we have moving forward, I just followed the processes for a reason, and I still feel confident in that decision.
Okay. And as Ted said, the board basically will stand by until further action that relates to board activity. Okay, thank you, Bill. Other business.
The only other thing I'd like to add, and I think that Dan Bailey kind of touched on that, we're really starting to hit working with building levels about textbook adoption. One of the very first things I heard in my new position was the concern that those billings came out right around holiday time, those types of things. And so we really want to start the processes earlier so that we can communicate better with parents the desire to help them budget accordingly for the beginning of that school year. So we're working with the building level principals, with secretaries, as we go through textbook adoption. Hopefully we'll be able to better communicate to parents and get that ball rolling so they can be looking forward to that. And I know that there are a lot of activities going on at the end of the year, so we just ask for your continued support and help. And if you have questions about what's going on in the buildings, be sure to contact those. But a lot of fun activities, including the high school graduation coming up soon. So we'll be looking forward to that as well.
Okay. Anything else?
I don't think so. Thank you.
Anything from the board? Anything from the audience? Okay, thank you for coming. We'll adjourn the meeting.